Give thanks to the Lord, for the Lord is good. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let those gathered in from every land say so. Let the church praising God through Jesus Christ say so.
Thank you.
but also for the sins of the whole world.
We trust the promise of God's love. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
So in the scripture today, later on, that gentleman right over there is going to be talking about John 3:16. And does anybody in this group right here know what that verse means to say? If you don't, it's okay. It goes on to say that for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, Jesus. Jesus is our Savior. It goes on also to say that he wants to shine the light so everyone can see Jesus. So when we think about how do we shine our light some ways and be good, kind of has to do with that hint about the cookie under the bed. Does anybody have any idea? How do we suggest, sir? So be nice to someone. Excellent. What about hug, or handshake, or wave, or sometimes those three simple words, I love you, you are my friend, I want to be your friend. Sometimes it's even thanks, or I know we parents like this, even with grown children, thank you, yes ma'am, yes sir. Goes a long way. So, I've got something else I want to show you. It's got to do with this flashlight that I've got over here. What does that look like to y'all? A heart. What else? Anybody got? Yes, sir.
Man.
All right. Hope y'all taking my props. Does it look like something might belong on somebody's head? See, I'm not a good artist. It could be an ear.
Kind of look like an ear, maybe?
Not even a leprechaun's ear? Okay, well, I didn't do real good in art class. However, I'm going to put the mic down just for a second.
However, if I turn this flashlight on, remember when I turn it on, what do y'all see now? See, that's kind of like God and Jesus want you to shine that light. And when we shine that light, that's us shining our light out for everyone to see. Turn this on. For everyone to seed for everyone to be good. So, we're going to shine our light from here on out, even when it's dark and gray, we're going to shine our light out. So, let's have a quick prayer. Dear God, your light shines through us for the whole world to see. Help us to share your love so there's no one in the dark about your love. Let your light shine in each of us and show God in everything that we do. Thank y'all very much.
Friends, let's pray together. Dear Holy Lord, by your Spirit, open us to the reality of your abundant and unending grace, your unending mercy, and your boundless love. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Our first lesson today is from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 10. You were dead through the trespasses and sins in which you once lived, following the course of this world, following the ruler, the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work among those who are disobedient. All of us once lived among them in the passions of our flesh, following the desires of flesh and senses, and we were by nature children of wrath like everyone else. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are what he has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life.
Thank you.
scripture lessons this Lenten season have focused upon the idea of the walk of Jesus towards Jerusalem and our own faith's solitary focus upon God's will. We've thought about this through the theme of the word only. Thinking about not the fullness of all the things that we do in the life of the church, but thinking about what's necessary, what's essential to distill down to what we can ponder closely. What's the essence of this life that we live with God through Jesus Christ? We've thought about the promise of God, how it is that we don't have proof of the things that we trust, but that we must believe and trust God, not on the basis of proof, but on the basis of it's God who makes the promise. We've thought about it, the life of faith as that kind of life. And today we think about the solitary attribute of God, which explains and impels all the other action of God in Jesus Christ. Only God's love. We hear it in Paul's letter to the Ephesians, as we've just heard, where God, out of the great love with which God loves us, has made us one with Christ. We hear it in today's gospel passage from the third chapter of the gospel according to John. Jesus is teaching a Jewish leader, Nicodemus, who has come to him in secret, teaching him about the nature of his own mission, Jesus' call. He says these words that start in our passage from verse 14. Hear the word of God. Jesus says, "Just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already, because they've not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world and people loved darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate the light and do not come to the light, so that their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God." This is the word of the Lord. So we start the sermon at a distinct disadvantage because I'm preaching on God's love today, only God's love, right? And here's the disadvantage, I'm not God. But we're okay because you aren't either. No, really, you're not. When human beings speak of God in any way, we must be careful. For us who are sinners and somehow broken in our natural state, to attempt to describe God's love, well, we run the risk of getting it wrong, distorting the picture, which almost can't help but really distort the picture, which is why so much of the message that we sometimes try to convey or we hear described
from well-meaning people about God, why it just, you know, rings false or falls short or something just misses the point. Because we talk in our culture all the time about love. But we don't really talk about it in terms of God as much as we do in terms of our own experience. And we who are not God, but we don't really know fully about how that is. They say that the Eskimos, the Inuit people, have 23 different words in their language for snow. And I'm thinking we must have 2,300 different uses of the word love in our culture. Because we love to use that word all the time. It's as if our vocabulary is impoverished enough so that we rely overly upon only the one word to describe too many different things. Like that dark chocolate that you just love. Or the warmth of your pet's snuggle. Or your devotion to a particular team. And around here, it's only one team, right? Just how we love that team. We throw the term around so easily and so cheaply. We love this and we love that. I used to love that new restaurant and love that show we've been binge watching. Love it. God, that looks so good. I did you love that? I love you, new hairdo. I never hear that, but that's okay. I just got an amen from Art Bain back there. The love that we talk about, the love that we throw around like that, is human love, right? It's our attempt to gin up a sense of high energy and high value for something that we truly do value. But what I want to say is, and I'm saying this as somebody who's got some experience with trying to do so, we do a whole lot better talking about God's love if we let God's word on love be our word for God's love. That is to say, if we don't start with ourselves and try to project onto God what our sense of God is, but if we start with God's Word, that is the Scripture that's given to us, God's Word written in Holy Writ, and God's Word that is made flesh in Jesus Christ, if we start with what God says and does in communicating the divine Word, then we have a better chance by far of understanding love that God has for us in Jesus Christ. That's what our Lenten season is about, right? We understand what's impelling Jesus to walk that path. How is it that Jesus showed up here in the first place? Because God so loved the world that he sent the Son. And how it is that that love that God has for us in Jesus Christ will take Jesus all the way to Calvary and into and out of the tomb of his real human death out of God's love for us. Have to start with God and God's love. I think that's the problem in our world, is that most people don't. And we can't blame them. Most people don't start with God's word on love. They don't start by reckoning what God does with love. They tell God who God is by projecting their own. Sometimes we're the ones doing it. We project onto God our own feelings. Which is why some people in our culture think that we are hypocrites, because we're talking about love or how sweet God is all the time, but all they see is how we're not living that life. What they do hear from us about God is something that emphasizes his judgment. How demanding God is, how stern God is, how you have to live a good life before God will start to feel something good towards you. They're getting that because that's what they're feeling in their own lives, from their own problems, their own sin is distorting their picture. And until and unless the right word about God comes, people will stay stuck in their wrong picture of God, and they will see God exactly the opposite from the way God truly is. They will not see God for love. They will see God as a God of hate. How can God allow that to happen? How can God judge people who aren't even responsible for their own situation? How can God expect me to do this? Do that? God doesn't understand. What I'm saying is that the default position is not to understand. And we who've been given the gift of the revelation of God in the Scriptures and in Jesus Christ our Lord, our Savior, must learn to interpret that word and understand the God who sends Jesus, who speaks the word to us, understand all that that message, that word, that love does mean. And when we do, we live our lives freely, more fully, more joyfully, more lovingly, and they get it better for us. If we let the Scripture tell us about God's love, then we get a picture about it. These two passages are beautiful for doing that for us. They slap us out of the complacency of thinking that our lives of faith are about us, and they help us to see correctly. That our lives of faith, our following Jesus, is the result of a successful rescue that God has made for us from sin into salvation through Jesus Christ. That's what Paul says in Ephesians, that we were dead in our trespasses. We used to live according to our own fallen human natures, living by flesh and by senses, just doing what feels right, according to that standard. But God, says Paul, God who is rich in mercy, out of the great love in which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace we have been saved. That salvation, that rescue, that's like the SWAT mission that goes into the enemy territory and that plucks us up and takes us out so that we have a chance to live the right kind of life, not benighted by our sin, not mesmerized by our sin, not having the wrong message about God. Sin is a ditch we cannot dig out of ourselves. So God has come to us. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us, says Paul. He rescued us. Paul says, why? It was out of the great love with which he loved us. It's out of love. We get that wrong, even in the church, we get that wrong all the time. We tell our children, you know, if you behave, you get to go to heaven. Or, if you behave, we'll get ice cream after worship. Just, you know, whatever. If you behave. We condition our response to our children, or we condition our response to each other based upon how it is that the other one behaves. And God's love is anything but conditioned by our behavior. It is unconditional, right? That's another word we throw around all the time, as if we know what it means. Let's ponder that word. It means it is not conditioned by anybody or anything else. God's love is not limited by our limitations. It is not diminished by our bad behavior or good. It was not triggered by our decision. Okay? God's love for you was not triggered by your decision to love God. Your decision to love God was triggered by God's love for you. Chew on that. Because while we were dead in our sins, Christ died for us. Christ did that out of the great love, out of the great love with which God loves us. God's love is unconditional. Ours is not, really. We're all the time responding. If we respond well and nicely and lovingly to people, that's good. It's hard for us to respond lovingly to people when they do not treat us nicely. You say in the church, like, everybody raise your hand if you're in favor of unconditional love. Everybody raise their hand, okay? First time somebody bumps us on the forehead, we go, "Hurry!" Clerk looked at me cross-eyed in the store. "Hey, you see that guy just cut me off in traffic?" "Your pastor said it yesterday." Our response is loving or otherwise conditional. God's love for us is not conditioned. It is absolute. It doesn't come from your behavior or your character. It comes out of God's character. It's who and how God is. And so that love impels Jesus into our world. And it explains Jesus' mission in the world. It's Jesus who doesn't want us not to know God's love. Otherwise, we wouldn't see it, we wouldn't feel it, and we wouldn't experience it. Out of the great love with which God loves us, God rescues us from our sins. That's the Ephesians passage, the John passage, which Martin Luther calls the gospel in miniature, right? Because it's all right there. It says it as well. And this is one that we have to unpack and protect from being too familiar with, right? God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever should believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. That action of salvation, which is a rescue from our mortal peril, is impelled by love. God loved the world so much that God did that. And God loved the world so much. That's good for us to wrestle with, too. Honestly, for the most of my life, when I've heard that, I've thought of God's love for the world being not just the town I'm in or the church I'm in, but God's love for the entire planet. And God loves, I promise you, best I understand, the entire planet. But I don't think that's what John's message here is. When you read John's gospel, and he uses the word world, it almost always refers to the unbelievers. It's like it's the insiders and the outsiders, like the religious folks and the world. The worthies and the unworthy. I think that's what Jesus is saying here, that God loves the world. Ugly, sin-ridden folk, unworthy, detestables, deplorables, the ones whose outward lives show that, whether they intend it or not. And those of us who've learned how to dress up that part of ourselves or pack it away so that other people don't see it as easily. The world. The rebellious part of human life. The diseased, sickened, twisted part of human life. God loves the world. God's love is and can do. Ours can't. It really just can't. We don't have the stomach to deal with the trouble that we face in ourselves and others most of the time. And we don't have the determination to stay with it and to hang with it all the way through. Which is why every 4 years a president will make some promises and it will sound so good, but we can't sustain it as a culture. And the kinds of transformations that really do matter, that are deeper than politics, those kinds of transformations, we need to rejigger every generation. Because we still have the same issues as human beings. But our great hope is that God loves the world. God loves the world. That love we see and experience in Jesus Christ. We don't do Christ justice until and unless we understand that Jesus is God's Word made flesh that accomplishes God's purpose. That Jesus is nothing less than God Almighty accomplishing that divine saving work. If we don't understand that Jesus and God are unless we get at the very deepest heart of why it is God does that. I think God wants us to understand it. How beautifully precious you are. How beautifully precious you are in God's sight. Even when you behave ugly and detestable and mean and short. Oh, how God loves us. Enough to rescue us. Enough to die for us. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Friends, in response to God's word proclaimed today, let's now stand and say with confidence what we believe using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell.
God, let us all catch a glimpse of the saving reality of your immeasurable love for us. Let us realize the transformative power of your undying, indescribable love as well. Lord, by Jesus Christ and through the faith in him gifted by you, we are moved from a destiny of death to the reality of eternal life. Through Christ, we are brought out of the darkness so that we now stand in the startling light of our Savior, and for that unearned blessing, we give you our praise and lift our songs of thanksgiving. Lord, you called us to be the church of Jesus Christ, so keep us one in faith, one in service. Let us break bread together and proclaim the good news to the world so all may believe that you are love. So all may turn to your ways and so we all can live in the light of your truth. Heavenly Father, refresh us by your Holy Spirit as we claim anew our faith in Jesus Christ and as we seek creative ways to show our love and thanksgiving to you and to the people you bless us to place in our lives around us. Lord, bless our church family. We ask that you comfort those who suffer loss. We ask that you bring wholeness and healing according to your good and perfect will to the sick. We ask that you strengthen those who take care of loved ones and help us to respond to the needs of our church members and to our neighbors that are both far and near. And today, Lord, hear our prayers for people amongst us who are sick and suffering, those who've gone through illness, those who are going through treatments or awaiting to find out what their treatment plan may be. Today, hear our prayers for Jim Barnett, for Bob Carson and Peggy Dorsey, for Donna Drake and Peggy Lastly, for Eloise Miller and Piper Schloss, who's the daughter of Martin Ashley. She is now recovering from surgery she just had completed last week. Lord, we present to you Helen Stone and Dell West. And our prayers go out to Mary Dill Branch, who is now going through surgery for a broken hip at St. Francis downtown. Lord, we lift up our praise and adoration to you for the good things done in this world and for healing and wholeness. We pray for Tom Dees and give thanks that Heather Pratt's father is now doing well and recovering at home. We present before you Laura Toner, Terry Setzer's daughter, who's been diagnosed with breast cancer. Lord, be with the people who serve. Be with our leaders in this world. Keep them focused on you. Let them show your love by the way that they care for and rule over us. And Lord, we pray everything that we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who taught us as his disciples to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, as the ushers come forward, let us remember that our offering is an active act of our worship in which we express our gratitude and reliance on God. So let us now give freely and with great joy.
Thank you.
your purpose and their distribution to the end that your kingdom may come and your will may be done on earth as it is in heaven. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our loving and risen Lord and Savior. Amen.
Of the Holy Spirit be yours now. Amen.